I'm Parminderjeet Singh. I am with IT for Change, which is an NGO based in Bangalore. And we work at the intersection of digital and social change, largely from equity and social justice viewpoint. And that's important that this background be stated. I am a part of this committee, which came out with this report. First, a disclaimer that though I would try to background the kind of ideas which are the reason things went the way they did, but of course they are either my ideas or my interpretation of what we were probably thinking. Another thing, I think time is short, I'll be forthright. I understand a lot of people here actually believe that NPD report should not have been there. They are ready to talk about whether we can have less pain or more pain, but behind it also there's a feeling if we had no pain altogether, it would have been a good thing. That also comes out a lot from the HasGeeks survey, very well done. I got very important points from it, but like 2/3 of people said, can we just not have NPD governance? So there's no point in a way also to discuss downstream issues about details when there is either a lack of clarity or a lack of agreement on upstream issues. So let's go it in the hierarchy of how things actually, meeting of minds take place or arguments and discussions can take place. So first the question, why do we have to govern NPD at all? And that's where I would like you now to start thinking. So let's start with things we may agree on. We may agree on that data is the most important resource of a new industrial era. I call it post-industrial, digital as being different from industrial, but whatever. There is a distinct new era, which is different from the industrial age. We are on the threshold of it, where data is the single most important resource. I also know computing resources are important, intelligence derived from data is important, but people recognize that data is the single most resource. And on this, I think most people would agree here. People still think that the personal data is the most important resource. It's not true. And I'm happy that Suchna talked a lot about people like us and data of people like us. It is a lot of data about people of certain categories which provides the real insights. AI is very happy to treat data in an anonymized manner as long as the basic patterns remain. So perhaps the most valuable data is non-personal data today. Personal data is also valuable because finally, when I have intelligence, I have to target that intelligence to specific people. And there, in the last phase of it, I need, again, personal data. Now, if non-personal data is one of the most important resource of the world, the question is, should it be governed at all or not? And whom does it benefit to govern it? And let's look at whom it benefits and whom it benefits not to govern it at all. I don't know, next stage, people may agree with me up to this point. Next stage is, would people agree that there is a huge amount of inequitable distribution of data power? It is very lopsided distribution, even more lopsided distribution than industrial age economic and social power used to be. I don't know whether people would agree with it, but that's another presumption that there is a very acute disbalance between of distribution of data power between nations, whereby China and US are becoming two poles, which will suck off all lot, if not all, AI power. And the world would revolve around it. They will outsource their intelligence to these two powers. And this is why Europe, and I will come to what Europe is doing about non-personal data, and they are also very much hovering around the kind of things which this committee has done. So there's a lot of disbalance between nations, but perhaps you are not so much into geopolitics and geoeconomics, but a lot of disbalance between people and big platforms. We all privately, or when we are not discussing data governance, are very happy to discuss the power of Twitter to be able to switch off an elected president, which however we may feel about Trump, does not instinctively look nice for somebody to be able to do that, or the power of Amazon, or the kind of problems Australia is having with Google, whether content makers should be paid something or not. So there is a huge disbalance of data power. And I hope people agree with me that there is a huge disbalance of data power as well. Now, if there's a disbalance, the question is, should we govern that data? We should allocate value of who takes the benefit of data in given circumstances. And this is what we have tried to do. We all agree that a person is a subject of data, but this committee goes into community as a collective subject of data. Again, this was talked about that even if I don't contribute data, there are people like me who would have contributed data and things can come back to me. And though I agree with Suchna that a lot of things have to be done about authorities who can protect harm, etc. But before that, it was important to establish a community's rights in its data. And that's what this report has done. But also I must remind you that this concept has a history. If you look at the document, which was a mandate of this committee, it already had the concept of community data. And if community data concept is already there, it is already implied that there is some data to which community has a right. And therefore it has a right of two kinds. One is to prevent harm. And second is to decide the benefits of it. And where this high value data sets, et cetera, come in, that how would the community control its data? So there, that's the background. If you want to really understand what is data sharing, think of data infrastructures. Now, this was, Vishu has talked about this word data trust has disappeared. It has been replaced by data infrastructure. If you want to understand what this committee is trying to do, it's trying to develop data infrastructures. In physical terms of industrial economy, there used to be certain economic activity which was infrastructures, and on the top of it, businesses used to run. Think of a road. Road is developed in a community in a public manner. So data-wise also, there's a huge thinking, and this committee believes that certain data is of infrastructure quality. And if there is, and this is one major proposition I want to put in front of you, that if there is a lot of data power disbalance, the disbalance is owing to a few global corporations who have captured the infrastructure of data. In industrial age, if somebody captures roads and ports and banks, then the power that company would have is disproportionate. And that's why they separated banking, ports, roads, as an infrastructural activity on the top of which different businesses would do their work. In that same sense, there's certain kind of data which are of an infrastructural kind. And if you want to understand what is a high value data set is that data which is considered under certain circumstances to have an infrastructure value which is necessary for all businesses in a category to be able to function properly. And if that infrastructure is captured by an early starter, as Google's and Amazon's and Twitter's and Facebook's of this world have done, then it becomes an unequal situation. And almost all digital problems, if I may say or make that bigger claim, are owing largely to the fact that data infrastructures are captured by early starters. And you can never be equal, therefore. So this is the disbalance which the committee is trying to correct. Now I'll come to what has really changed and what it tries to do. It's very difficult to try to correct disbalance around an artifact which is considered the central value of a digital economy or a whole society. A lot of people have loosely spoken of proprietary rights about data. If you really go and read the literature, there's hardly real legal right on data. They don't exist. I've studied for weeks about what is existing set of IP rights over data. They really don't exist in any strong manner. So the question was that certain kinds of data, it's not all data, not even all non-personal data, but certain kinds of community data, which is sourced from outside, from people, from communities, from public infrastructure and so on, would be called community data, and community would consider to have a right over it, and thereby establish very high degrees of duty of protection, harm protection, and also be able to use it when necessary for building data infrastructures. Now, first of all, to make that kind of a shift, it was very important to establish a clear right, because unless you establish right, all this talk about voluntary data sharing, data altruism, simply doesn't work. Let's be real. I mean, we are in a hard law ground when you're talking about the most valuable resource of this this society. Now, while we were establishing shared right, and that's the big change in the new version, the problem was, would it happen that the day the legislation comes, everybody can ask everybody else data and the old system will completely collapse? So while we wanted to establish a default right, but the way data sharing would take place would be very gradual. And that gradualness has been established through the high value data set, that only such data which is recognized and consented by the non-personal data authority as being of infrastructural nature would be asked for. Even the kind of data which can be asked for, the grounds, not the grounds, the fields, et cetera, will be determined. I won't ask for a whole database. I will only ask for certain transportation data, which is considered to be of an infrastructural nature. And I keep on using that term infrastructure because that's key to understanding what this committee is trying to do. The data of an infrastructural nature can be taken and we will all go one by one. And that's why the committee say, as a pilot, start with health data. When we do health data, we learn a lot of things and things will change. So while we established a default right that community has, that right is necessary because this is a hardcore political economy. This is my thing. Unless you really tell that, no, sorry, this kind of data is not your property, it is community property. Unless you make that legal property right kind of a thing with the community, you can't really ask for data sharing. But once you have established it, the right only kicks in a very constrained process. The process has been defined and its guidelines would be made clearer and clearer. So there's a lot of certainty for the balances. The last thing for the startups and other businesses, the last thing I want to say is that why would then startups be unhappy? Before that, I would also say that there is a Data Act which will come in Europe in this year, 2021, which is going to talk about compulsory data sharing. It's going to talk about B2B right to access data. These are words which are there already in the data strategy, which says that these are the things which the Data Act will come up with, right to access in a B2B context. They are going to come up with it. And I think we have done a little better than what they have done. And I don't have the time to go into how they do not use a community rights background framework, in which ways our committee's report is much better. But there is another Digital Markets Act, which the draft is out, which I don't know why people have noticed, that gives right to business users of platforms to NPD about them. That is like Amazon traders who have their collective data about, say, diapers, or their data about fountain pens, etc. Makers of fountain pens have data on Amazon individually, and aggregated data can be taken back by them. They can ask for it. So there's again an NPD right they have established. This committee did not establish rights for business users. It only did it for a community of natural people. So that's the difference. And why would therefore all startups be immediately not be happy? And that's my last point. I'll just take 30 seconds. And I can understand that. Currently, startups exist in a business environment which is determined by a certain Silicon Valley model. And most businesses in this area have a 6 to 8 month of a vision. That's the hard facts of this business. And they're happy to, they've developed their whole business model in that Silicon Valley model thing, whether it is to be the next Google or sell out to Google in 3 years, or to Facebook or to Twitter, all the biggies, or to Baidu or any of those Alibabas. So the problem is that it's very difficult from them to see it in their 6 or 8 months window, which they have to sell to the venture funder, their business model, how things will change. This is a normal, it's been called a business dilemma, social choice theory problem, that if you ask individuals, would you develop an infrastructure? They say, we are very happy with the way we are. So somebody else has to come and say, no, give up a part of land of all houses because a road has to be made there. So it's like developing an infrastructure, and very much understand why current startups may be a little nervous about, because they've only projected themselves in this mainstream global model as we exist. I don't think things will change too much because the whole process of this committee's report's implementation is to go one by one. Even in one sector where they go, for example, health, they would go for very few data sets which are supposed to be compulsorily shared. we will learn, but finally, like we had it in the industrial age, certain data would be infrastructural, which will be commons. Other data would be proprietary, on which competitive advantage will be built. So my vision is have an infrastructure of data, on top of it, have intelligent services, which are your competitive advantage, and don't make data hoarding your competitive advantage. So things will start shifting in that direction. And this is what this committee has tried to do. I've stuck to the overview. Specifics, I can answer that, but I think I should stop now. To get, if people don't get this vision of what is being tried to be done, then it's very difficult to discuss downstream issues.
Hi, Parminder. Thanks for the clarification. I think the big picture understanding is really critical. So how are you seeing the roadmap forward? Will there be another V3 of this, or the committee is going to hand off and then look for more implementation learning before you revisit? Or what is the current thinking about the roadmap going forward from a committee's perspective? So Scribble Data is a data processor. If the NPD implementation actually goes through, it is likely that we will be the, our systems will be the ones that will be generating the metadata that will be submitted, and we will be building the HVDs on our kind of platform. We are a data preparation company for machine learning. So I come at this thing from a not so much on a value judgment point of view. I know that this is a massive battle, but I'm looking at it from a practical implementation challenges. And so the when my clients ask me, they're essentially asking, okay, over what time frame is this going to be implemented, in what sequence, so that they can appropriately build up the capacity in the organization. I can talk a little bit about the enterprise data environments. But what I really wanted to take away from Parminder is, I think we have seen the journey until now. How does the committee see the way forward for this?
What happens going forward is generally a decision of the committee and then also the government people who are associated. However, the very point of having consultations is that there would be they would be taken, unless we really, it's very unlikely that no point we received was worth tinkering at all, the old version, that's unlikely. So that's the whole point of taking views, is to see those views against what is in there, and something or other may just get changed. And I described the larger thing, which I don't think would get changed because it's part of this committee's mindset, it's government's mindset, it is developing countries' mindset is a bigger thing. Though, Venkata, I think I should, you can ask me offline. I wasn't very sure the kind of metadata you are talking about as your core work is the metadata we are asking to be shared there. So probably it will not affect in that manner. Metadata registry is just the, is just kind of a public disclosures like you, the public listed companies do about their basic, you know, businesses and what divisions of businesses and what do they do, etc. It's a very skeletal describing your nature of your data process. I collect data from hospitals and I do this. I have a back office thing. You know, it's that kind of a thing. Rest, actual data sharing thing is a different thing. Whether your kind of work would come in that HVD, sure. Thing is a different matter. So there are okay. Two different things, but we can talk about it.
Yeah, I think that helps. I mean, we do see that there will be multiple levels of this thing. So one major concern that I had was that if you look at the enterprise data environments, right, they also generate a lot of data sets. But our experience has been that a lot of that is very messy internally. It's very people heavy and very laborious activity. So one of the things I was reading in the V1 as well as V2 is a lot of tangible costs, right? I can literally point out to, you will have to hire some this kind of people and this kind of people and track this kind of information and so on. But from an economic architecture, what I'm not finding is as many upsides or incentive for the data business to be a good data citizen. You can force it through the lines of the law saying that thou shalt do this. But I think the intent of the committee is to go beyond that and have good data citizens in this ecosystem. And that incentive alignment is something that concerns me. And all of this is, you know, both the data engineering, the sheer costs of all of these things and the availability of people, there are lots of resource limitations of organizations there. So the first one is the larger economic architecture. There is still a little bit of uncertainty. I expect that it will happen over a period of time. Just wanted some thoughts about how you see the economy developing. The other thought which was that came to our mind is that from everything that we know about data usage, it is absolutely necessary to have a guarantor of the data. Somebody should sign the dotted line saying that this data is actually, it is complete, it has integrity and so on. HVD that way could be a potential template for, you know, if the committee decides to expand, because what we saw in Trustee is ultimately somebody who will sign the dotted line and say, this data is good for the following reasons. And that without the guarantor, there's no way we saw that the economy would work. That was the second thought that we had. And the third thing came up during our conversation, which is the, you talked in terms of infrastructure. I wondered if you would go to the next step and expand this notion of, extend the notion of neutrality to this space as well. Is there an analogy of net neutrality in the data space that you are seeing? Let me hold here, and there are a bunch of other interesting thoughts as well that I'm hoping to hear from others.
Sure. Thank you so much, Venkata. So now I'd just like to invite Saranya to sort of give her thoughts on like the conversation. So
could I ask for
partner as well as introduce herself?
Quick response to you, Saranya. To my thought?
Sure. Yeah, okay. Absolutely. Parminder, please see to Saranya, then we'll come to you.
Sorry, I mean, whichever way. So I understand, Venkata, the cost-wise, you know, we have only tried to lay the principle. It is like, once we agree that, you know, we also have to see the larger society. When we want to talk about Twitter and, you know, Google issues, then we say, no, those powers are bad. But when we come out to businesses, they say, don't do anything. If financial audit, which is a very expensive enterprise, is required, because finance is something which is very, you know, valuable. So data is also, we are only talking about AI audits. We can't have AI audits before we have data audits. So without having certain processes, and in this committee, we've only recognized the principle. We have not even gone one step down to say what it would be. And it keeps on saying it will be light. So if we don't agree at a principle level, that's the only point here. Rest all will come as we would do to maximize our digital industry's interest. Second, I love the point about that infrastructure is like roads. You know, you can't just make roads and they are full of potholes and, you know, not to proper engineering. So governments or trustees, when they get into this business as an industrial age, governments also became experts of making roads, making, you know, ports. Earlier governments were only for security on your danda and your horse and, you know, only do security, but they become experts of certain kind of productive activity. And I completely agree that they should become experts not only to take data and make an infrastructure, but the infrastructure should be able to only provide that data as an infrastructure, which is somehow guaranteed to be good data. And this definitely should be a layer which should be added to the job of the trustees and rather the responsibilities of the trustees. I agree with it. Neutrality in data space, very much so. There is a Data Governance Act, Draft Data Governance Act of the EU, right now on consultation. We are going to submit our thing, which develops, Europe is developing this concept of European data spaces. They're very much like data infrastructures, actually. They've just not used the community rights framework, and I will separate discussion tell you why this community rights framework is better than the eminent domain framework, where government takes the data without a community right. Community rights framework gives a lot of inherent potential of a participative design. The very fact that it's a community rights framework, and government just does not take data, but no time for that. Yes. And they talk about data sharing services being neutral services, and government will only stamp them as neutral services if they comply to certain lists. So it's a beautiful Data Governance Act. If you search for it, you'll get it, and think these kind of things should be required for any data sharing services. And the data trustee is supposed to be a data sharing services. It should have a very long list of compliance on neutrality.
Good evening, everyone. And thank you to the Hasbeak team for setting up this conversation. Most importantly, I like the framing of this panel, which is the motivations and the intentions behind the drafting of the framework in itself. And needless to say, thank you to Parminder for sharing his thoughts. I think whichever way you look at it, the panel was given an imposing mandate of squaring a huge circle. And they've drafted one framework and have taken in feedback and applied it and come with the next one. So I would like to, at the outset, say that, kudos to the work being done. And unfortunately, I think there's still a long road ahead. So I think some aspects have already been touched upon. I will reiterate it from a slightly different perspective. Due to the other panelists for their thoughts on that. I think one part which I think there should be some sense of agreement on is to what Suchna had said, the limitations of consent is, I think, an understood limitation on this grander, larger concept, and I won't get into that in detail. But even in seeking for consent to anonymize data, I think there's a certain granularity required. Because there is a difference between consent for anonymization of the data for use by the organization or by the company with which you're interacting, for use by the company to give to third parties for purposes which are in the normal course of business, and then at a third level, additional consent for anonymization of data to be contemplated within the non-personal data framework, to become a high-value data set, to be shared with a third party, which currently nobody can really name. Which brings me to the second one. I think the consent piece, if that is the bedrock at which we as an as a country have agreed that personal data sharing as well as non-personal data sharing is concerned, a slightly allied concept of choice of the consumer may seek to be neutralized by the concept of non-personal data. For example, today consumer choices are not fungible as to the cheapest biscuit and I will go there. I think as we progress as a consumer, understandably, this is a concept which is not as permeated in a young economy but still a developing economy like India. But as choices develop, there are choices made on several factors. For example, I may choose to work with a Flipkart because let's say I believe in their labor practices. I believe in their inclusivity challenge. You can already see that on, let's say, choices many brands, and we can get into the ethics of that in a bit, but the point is the choices are more 360 degree than just and are not fully fungible. In which case, I as a consumer, I'm choosing to interact or buy my product from this particular company. And in that, I'm voting with my purchase as to the company that I want to benefit from my purchase. In which case, by saying that this company's data, which we are saying is of value, the data which is given to this company, can then be shared to any other company, is not something I'm interested in. I'm very conscious of the choices I'm making, I'm conscious of the company that I'm enriching with not just my dollar, but also with my data. And that choice of the consumer is getting neutralized to a large extent in this concept of the consumer has participated, now leave them out of the conversation. And we can trade between the organizations as we deem fit. I agree that there is the idea of the consumer being a data beneficiary who can then frame or influence that argument through the data trustee. However, one can easily argue that in a country like India, we have a bunch more of nuance to get into as to how that data beneficiary will intra and inter organize themselves to be able to adequately influence the movement of that. Will there be veto power? Will there be majority? Will there be any one person is allowed to come in? I think obviously there's a lot to be taken on and will be taken on a case-by-case basis. So that is the second piece. I think there's and this will kind of come back a little bit later. The third piece to what Venkata had mentioned is definitely the absence of incentives to be an enthusiastic participant. I think one is organizing the data properly. One is even ensuring the data is up to date. If I as a requester, even if we assume that, now the requester is somebody who is registered in India. We can get into the foreign Indian aspect and the coloring of it and what is the line of that. I'm sure that's a conversation that I'm sure Parminder has been part of in many forms and ways. So I won't get into that at this point. But a data requester in going and making a demand of a company to expend resources, to update their data set, we are saying that is based on the community data aspect. And I think that's a fairly nebulous framing on which any organization can go and demand an expansion of resources. To this point, I think it is interesting to see how we will enforce this beyond a stick method, beyond a you will be fined for it and so on and so forth, because I think that is really the core of what we are trying to achieve over here. How do we understand, or if there is a way in which we can encourage positively organizations to update and work on their data sets without necessarily penalizing it, I think we've cracked a huge part of the problem to address even existing open data sets, right? Case in point, RBI's data sets are live and available. As a co-founder of an industry body which works in the payments data space, I can tell you that the data is something which we publish every month. And by that I mean it's only something that we collate and reframe from what is available government data sets. I can tell you a particular data set of intense value for me from the RBI has not been updated past October 2020. I'm not finding fault in that. RBI has nonetheless been very caught up with things. But if there is a positive framework with which we can encourage RBI to update its data sets, I think that does a large part of the job without saying that only if Amazon gives all of the data sets and we crack that problem is the non-personal data problem cracked. Which brings me to my last point. The road infrastructure example that Parminder had quoted is spot on. And I think that's a wonderful framing which gives a great understanding of what the piece is. In expecting good public infrastructure, which everybody can benefit of in this country as a citizen, the expectation is not that everybody takes a piece of gravel from their house and goes and participates in the road building, right? The job I've done is as a taxpaying citizen. I've paid my taxes. And I've done my job in that. As long as every company is a tax-paying organization, as long as the income tax laws of this country have in their wisdom made choices how foreign-owned entities will be paying tax to this country, as long as DIPP, erstwhile DIPP, has taken a choice in its wisdom to allow for 100% investment in the technology sector, how are we in a well-placed position to, over and above them paying tax, them hiring and complying with whatever foreign investment compliances, such as hiring so many percentage as Indian professionals and so on and so forth. Over and above that, penalizing them, and I quote that because I know that may not be a fair framing, but over and above that, saying you still have more blood to shed for your maybe for to make up from for the origin of your organization. But having said that, that's not a distinction made in the report at all. That distinction is not a fair one to read into the report, that it was only to be aimed at a foreign entity or not. It is very much expected that a large Indian entity will also be, and by large, this is only as a threshold of data business, will also be subject to this. As an Indian company which has paid taxes and hired Indians, am I forced to also do more? Admittedly, there is a contour of without forming harm to the data custodian, but in the absence of defining that harm, with the very intent that this non-personal data from the data custodian is going to enrich somebody else, what is really the, on a principle basis, how much more can we demand from the companies? Which brings me to the last point. In all of this, I fully recognize that there's a larger problem statement which is being trying to be addressed. And as Parminder has said, as there is an appreciation of where we are as a country, as an appreciation of where we are geopolitically, this is not something which possibly we can move in inches or miles through, you know, conversations like this. I fully appreciate that this group is, that the committee has been open to feedback. And I genuinely respect that. I mean, you know, it's not lip service that so much participation by the committee members is not to be taken lightly. My only suggestion would be, considering that this is a mammoth task that we're all trying to perfect at one shot, which is a little difficult to do, is there a possibility that we can first perfect this attempt for, let's say, government data sets or government-funded institutes, ensure that the framework works perfectly in those contexts, and then extend it to private entities where there all of these conversations will become a little clearer. I think there's too much data with regards to weather, with regards to government-funded data sets, with regards to even, I mean, various forms of financial inclusion. The State Bank of India, if we have to get really nitpicky, where so much of taxpaying money has gone into it and the demands from that organization are possibly on a slightly stronger footing to be able to say, hey, you are funded by us taxpaying citizens of the country. You have an obligation to create and clean up data sets and make it available for the larger country. Do that. And I'm not saying that that obligation doesn't involve to private companies, but perfecting it in that framework, which itself will be a very important and big task, can then give everybody a little better feeling when we try to extend it to the private economy as and when that happens. And with that, I will take pause. Thank you.
Hey, thanks. I'm Arvind. I'm a co-founder of Nitya Learn. So we are in the human learning space, not machine learning space. So it is, we train people. It's a B2B SaaS company. So I first want to thank Parminder, and I probably would start off, I think it's not only to say where we disagree. I think the first part, what you said, that non-personal data is huge. It's larger than actually the personal data in the value that it has. Completely agreed. And I also think a regulation for this is necessary. So the basic question of whether if you're looking for agreements here, I think there is an agreement, at least from my side here. And I'm talking here more as a citizen rather than a very startup focused founder view. And I think overall, the point what you said, whether larger companies, in a way, it is a winner take it all. Once the first one collects data, the data becomes a monopoly. And also that you have a data monopoly in one area, you can actually create a data monopoly across in multiple areas. And this is essentially, in some way, this has to be handled, or you need to create enough regulation to help even antitrust frameworks to start working on here. So I think one of the biggest concern many startups have and so on is also how much of this will start impacting smaller companies, smaller startups and so on. And I think overall, the thresholds are very important, and maybe specifying a little more on the size of the thresholds or values of the thresholds on where it'll be. Is it going to be really at very large companies that we are talking about where this would be mandated? Would be, I think, helping continue a lot of discussion with many, because I think there is clearly a value in saying that the first and after a certain size is also having valuable data that you can use it for any of your so-called infrastructure of data. If the data is collected is not sufficient in volume, then that data is probably also not going to be very useful. So maybe a threshold to say that this whole thing is applicable only at a certain size, and the size is large enough that small players are not having to be worried about the red tapes that it would cause and stifle innovation here. So that is one of the points I was having when I was looking through this. And The second point was the high value data that we are talking about is very focused on how do you use that value for creating more public good. I think there should also be more points around how can these non-personal data actually be misused and how can we prevent that. So the point I said around in audit and so on was in those lines. Are the ways the data that is used used in some way, which is today not illegal, but it is something that is taking us in the wrong direction, like a large amount of data used to, let's say, help or break democracy in some way, help election results change in one way or the other, or create silos and create kind of echo chambers to give people a certain set of view because you understand from the data who are in what ways. So there are ways we understand now data can actually be misused as well. And also the point I was talking about, the experiment that we are running with a lot of people actually giving that data, and a lot of personal intricate information is available to the big techs. And controlling this is something not only asking them to share that information, but also to see what kind of information can be collected, the non-personal data, and how it can be put to use. The regulation should also look at that aspect of it. Those are the main points. I think there were other points may be touched by others. I don't want to repeat them.
Yeah, first of all, it's a very nice session. Thanks for organizing HasGeek. And Parminder clearly explained why the NPD framework is required. In fact, this session is very, very helpful. And if you go through the framework itself, you may not get the details like why it is needed. I like the analogy of the roots, whatever you give, Parminder. I have three questions, basically. One is the with respect to privacy education, engineering side. Okay, if you see the National's AI strategy paper, clearly they mentioned that right, academia and the industry needs to work with various courses to offer for the engineering students so that right people will get build the expertise and education experience and the AI and machine learning side. But whereas in the privacy side, in my opinion, we don't have any such kind of initiatives. Okay. In fact, like in US, only one university, like Carnegie Mellon University, offers a privacy engineering master's. Okay. In Europe, there is one online course from Switzerland. But whereas if you see that Indian universities right now, I don't see any universities which are offering privacy engineering as a in master's or in at a graduate level itself. So that will be one of the first thing maybe before framing any personal data framework or non-personal data framework, right? The government has to work with the academia and industries to build the expertise and experience on the privacy engineering side as well. Okay. The second one is the data consent management. Okay. So right now, if I go and visit any website, it asks for, hey, we are storing some cookies, whether you opt in or opt out and all. Okay. So then if I am in a hurry, so I will not read their privacy policies. I will go there and then I will blindly accept it. Okay. So then there are some disadvantages of doing that. And then nowadays, right, people may not have time, and then lack of education also, right? People see nowadays like the mobile penetration in India is too much, okay? And then people will watch all kinds of sites, okay? They don't know what data they are, all other companies are taking and all, right? And on top of that, if you ask saying that, hey, all the companies has to collect the consent for anonymous data sets as well, then that will be too much itself, right? And then people may not be right in a position to judge what companies are collecting it, how they are using it all. First of all, my point is basically we have to educate, right? And then if a bank is asking for some data, right, typically, right, they will explain, hey, why they are collecting the data. So similarly, like the education is very much important in that way, right? People will come to know like why, what they are contributing, how their particular data is being utilized. And the third point is like Saranya mentioned, right? I know like Parminder, you may say that first of all, you have to agree principally about all the regulations, whatever you're talking about. But it will be good to showcase some reference implementations, right? Once you agree that, assume like if you have agreed that these are the principles which you are agreeing it. So then we'll come to know like what are the typical challenges when processing these large amounts of data, right? And like whatever she mentioned, right? Like, and the data cleaning or providing the data sets in a regular manner. So then we'll come to know the real challenges, and then I completely agree that we should have some framework. And then I'm glad that from India, we are driving some of these non-personal data frameworks, and then which are much stricter than other countries as well. Okay, that's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you so much for organizing this event. So I'm Shubho, I'm from a company called AppNox, and it's into application security. And I am a kind of a, privacy, want to advocate privacy, and that's what I stand for, right? So I have few comments and few questions, right? So one of the things which I did not hear across through this whole talk is the word democracy, democratizing the whole data itself, right? So that is not something, I understand that this is not a personal data, but it's non-personal data, but still the data, who should own the data, should, and it is the user who is owning the data. So he has every right to go ahead and say, no, I don't want to share my data. And then what happens? Does that get reflected back into your, high value data set? Does it goes ahead and erase that? So what is the action taken forward? Or is there a way where me as a citizen, I want to go ahead and remove anything which is related to me, right? So that's something which I am concerned a little bit about, right? The second thing which I do have in mind is the data security part of it. Mostly because this is the community data, and which is rightly said that this is the most powerful data, right? Because even if it is not a personal data, and if I have a community data, I can basically create models to mimic one fake, model of a community, because I have all the data entry points over there. So what is it that, how do these accessor of the data, which is there for the, for other companies to access these data, how are you going to control those accesses? What is there a fair usage policy you have to access those kind of data, right? So that is another very important question which I do have in mind. The third thing which I want to also bring into picture is the word open governance, because there are a lot of data provided by our government itself, right? I understand the fact that finance world has a lot of open data, which they already have, but there are other realms in the government where there are open, for example, law has a lot of open data, right? So it will be better for the government to come up with a high value data set of non-personal data. And then I think step two would be to go ahead and ask private companies to, follow the same or go ahead. And the fourth and the very important point, since I'm running a business sitting out of India, in the whole world, right? What is the boundary of the data which, as a private company, I should be sharing in this data team, right? Because today I may not have a demarcated data. This set of data is based out of data which I've aggregated in India, and these kind of data which have data I've aggregated from outside India. And we do not have those kind of demarcation. Are those kind of demarcations being, spoken about or been thought about? That's another very important thing as a startup I can think about, right? And one last question which I do have, I just want to be concise and crisp, is data sharing, right? I think that this NPD policy which is coming up, it should also be taken into the world stage, because let's say if European Union comes up with another NPD, and if India comes up with another NPD, and let's say Singapore comes up with another NPD, it becomes a real hassle for a small startup or even for a bigger organization to make sure that we align our data according to whatever the inputs which you want or which the other countries want, right? So I think there has to be kind of two umbrellas. One would be something in terms of global, where if India can push for that,
that's going to be an amazing thing. And of course, something related to India, which is a smaller umbrella under the bigger global umbrella. So these are my thoughts and questions.
So Saranya's question about consent, I argued in the committee also. I think consent for anonymization is already a part of PDP. There has been a difference of views. I leave it out. But my belief, because anonymization itself is a processing and processing is covered under PDP, I think it's already there. In the committee also, I argued that. But that's a different matter. You are talking about a more granular consent. That's a big problem. But I think once the lines have drawn that I give consent for only this company to use it, not give it to other company, and whether to give it HVD. Now, this creates an issue. I think we will come to it. I myself am a believer that provenance of a data should be recorded permanently in some way without even identifying it personally. It's a very complex thing. How once the identification has been removed, the consent structures remain. And yeah. I'm ready to explore that new system because I believe in the rights of both the people and the community whose data it was. And I have been a votary of international arrangement where the source country and the source community would have the rights wherever the data finally resides. And it again needs a provenance tracing, which what you are talking about. How, whether veto power or majority, how communities will take those decisions is a complex thing. Things happen in the world. They already take many decisions about forest, about water. They are not unknown. That's why community resource frameworks have been talked about in the committee. We can always keep on, you know, saying that it can't happen. Problem is, what is the trade-off involved? Existing open data, something which Subo also says. Now, there are two different questions. We cannot do that, you know, problem is here, and why don't we do that first? Why government doesn't, you know, improve primary education before they go to higher education? Why they don't improve technical education? It doesn't work like that. Governments do whatever is important. So we, open data is a different kind of a problem. And somebody says the data power is in RBI data, and it is not in Amazon data. That's not true. 90% of data power right now is with data, with the platforms. Governments have to do something about it while they're not doing a great work or doing a great work elsewhere or not. Whether you've already paid their taxes, and why should I contribute to a data infrastructure? Data infrastructure is a very different kind of infrastructure. Even if government had all the money, you can't make data infrastructures. You can make new roads, you can make ports, but you can't make data infrastructures because data infrastructures would not be sold by Google and Amazon, first of all. Second, they need a real-time flow of data. There are many complexities. I've written in a paper, I can share it, that even if you had those billions of dollars which you can use to make roads, you cannot actually make data infrastructure. So that's a problem out there. Again, Arvindam has said that how it is, I agree, the threshold is very important. I am myself a great votary that it is a big data sets which are the infrastructural ones, and we shouldn't be going towards smaller companies. The threshold should really be good. I agree with that point. How can be misused? Absolutely a great, great point. It is. It has to be a jurisprudence and guidelines which how communities work have to evolve. There's a big potential of misuse. Again, there's nothing in the principle which helps that misuse, but this is a downstream issue which is very, very important, that how data can be misused. The duty of harm has been put, and all these high standards of duty of harm, etc., required a community right to data. Because if you don't have a community right, the harm harm thresholds are very low. It's a normal harm. You can't harm. But if it is my data, the harm thresholds become very high. It is a data about South Indians living in certain area and their food habits. The harm, by establishing that principle, the right, the data is theirs, increases the harm threshold, jurisprudence very high. And within that, a lot of things can be worked out. So the principle has been made, the data would always be remain. And I just want to contribute one important point. Why, and Saranya also, this is a very new kind of asset. It is intelligence about me. It is intelligence about people like me. And there's a moral philosophical argument that intelligence about me and people like us should be somehow controlled by me. So there's not this old time.
Agreed. I completely agree with you. No, so my point is,
a physical property, you know, if you can say something, Saranya, you're saying something.
No, please go ahead.
So this is not that old-fashioned physical property thing that my house has been taken for your road. Intelligence about me, intelligence about people like me, whether it is a certain, you know, sex category or whether it is a cultural category, is, and this is just laying a principle, and then equity and fairness will come into the kind of issues which you are describing, that people who have done business also need their entitlements. Democracy is what Srinivasan said, education, and completely agree. Reference implementation method, that's why they have said first do health data. Health data globally, there is much more agreement that there are community rights to health data. There's a WHO framework, the other frameworks on COVID, a new one had come. So that becomes a ref, because there's a greater agreement about the public interest aspect of health data. So once we do that, we will be much able to do education, transportation, and that's why we are trying to say use a pilot, and that's going to be the reference thing. But unless you make those laws and principles, nothing moves. Subho, you said democracy, but just one thing, you know, democracy, we don't understand that is also a community right and individual rights. I vote in certain manner, but my constituency votes in a certain manner. I accept that representative, that I cannot keep on saying, no, I want to be able to say what this guy says in the parliament. The many things in democracy are bunched by community and collective decisions. So democracy is both the individual right and the community right. Open data is a question which Saranya said, we have already said. Outside data and inside data, you said, and this old question of provenance problem comes. And I think, like finances, we are now forced to keep many documents, right? I have to keep it, you know, my logistics documents, my supply documents. It will become complex, because if data is underpinning the value system, then its auditing, its requirements will be complex, and there would be some complexity about inside data and outside data are at least separatable in the same way we wanted it separated later. And harmonization globally, you know, there's a last point I want to say. We have always been norm takers. We never made norms. And there's a recent paper by EU which very clearly says we want to be norm givers, not takers, on digital policy. So India can also get up and say that I would not wait for a GDPR to come and then do something. I would give the norms first. We will negotiate internationally. We are working, IT for Change is working with the South Center, is trying to develop a global model law, which is pro-South and pro-developing countries. And then negotiations will take place and improve. But you cannot wait for the US or EU to give you the global format. You put it, the ball out first, negotiate it. But that's what this time we are trying to do. So I wanted to quickly touch most.
Thanks so much, Parminder. Saranya, sorry, you were saying something. Do you want to very quickly respond to that? And then we'll wrap the session up.
Unless sure. Someone else also has response. Absolutely. No, I think Parminder, points well taken. I think the couple of caveats is, first of all, I completely take the point that it's not a matter of unless and until we do it for X, we can't do it for Y. I take your point on board. I think it's a question of just as you mentioned, seeing an implementation with all of its nuances and considering there is still a negotiation, there is strong feedback on the basic principles of whether or not those pieces can be, or the data can be demanded from the private institutions on the same footing as one can demand from a government institution. The thought process was getting it implemented through a government institution where there is no, where there is large consensus on the rights and the demands to be made. That was the thought process. But having said that, I think in as much as India taking this bull by the horns and saying let's be the front runners in this conversation, there is complete value to that. The only thing is in 3.6 also, I think of the framework, if I'm not mistaken, I think you enumerate the interests in the pursuant to which this framework is pursued, which is incentivization towards innovation and towards benefits. So far, and maybe this is putting a too fine a point on things, the economic benefit to the community, I'm not able to see a very clear example. I'm happy to take this offline and possibly there is some context to be added on over there. But nonetheless, very glad that this conversation is moving forward, and thank you so much for your responses.
Just a comment. So just wanted to define democracy. Democracy doesn't always mean deleting data. So democracy meaning currently, let's say if my father has not signed up on any of the social platforms or anything, and today if he signs up for one, and now his data is now being available in across all the data aggregators and across everything. So a democracy in choosing to share it or not is what a democracy would be. Right, so that's one small thing which I wanted to see. The other thing which I also have been hearing and just wanted to comment on this, But you are coming, the European Union is coming with non-personal data act and everything. But till today, as far as I know, I'm not sure what's happening internally. They still couldn't categorize that this is what a non-personal data is. And that's something which is still up for debate and a lot of speculation. But so I'm happy that we are also doing this, right? So yeah, just two comments which I just wanted to bring into